already that home sickness might have creeped in, because many of you have come from different places and staying in this college in the hostel for last 5 days, right? I know your urgency, and postman session is generally regarded as the graveyard session for obvious reasons, because of the the hospitality provided here and the great lunch we had. So definitely it will make you to scream. No problem, because it is not you who are who is going to scream. It is a bacteria in your gut asking you to scream, right? As Dr. Shashidhar mentioned, many of our behaviors are not from the brain or the neurons. It is by the microbes which we have in our gut and at various parts of the body. So, even the or not the methodical or systematic research, there are a lot of opportunities available for you to do research after your MBBS or even after post graduation in medical sciences. So it's a very good area, because in India this is still an opening up, it's an opening field. It means lot of opportunities are there, and also we have only for India we have specific diseases also. For example, diabetic. India is considered as the capital of diabetes, right? Why there is a diabetes in India more prominent, or the rate of the number of patients of diabetes is increasing? These are the concerns, and we don't have solution. We cannot get the solution from Europe or US, because that is not specific to those countries. So we need Indian research. After doing medicine, you can pursue research in medical area or clinical area. Data collection, simple. If you are practicing doctor, still you can do research by collecting the data of the patients, and what type of data, what is their economic stage, what is the type of food they eat, and what are they prone for, like that. These data also help in developing the drugs which are specific to our country. So there is a lot of opportunities in the medical area. But I suggest you, to those who have given the chits here, I suggest you to do research after doing your MBBS or post graduation. I'll tell you why, for which is common for all. Okay, the second one, the second highest number, is that. I think this is civil services. The second highest number is engineering, and now the inclination towards doing engineering is decreasing. There are many colleges which are going vacant. Seats are not getting filled up, not only in Karnataka, but it's a common trend all across the country. In Tamil Nadu, for example, just to give you statistics, only 47% of the total seats available are filled up. Only 47 out of 1,72,000 seats available, hardly 86 or 90,000 seats have been filled, not less than that. 47% have been filled up. And also same in Gujarat and Maharashtra and so many states. Fancy or the interest towards engineering is declining, mainly because it is not fetching the rewards what it was earlier used to fetch. The salaries are going down, the jobs are not available, so students are opting out of engineering. But still there are many good colleges you can do pursue engineering. But for this community in the sense, top 1% in your 10th standard, those who are assembled here, you are all qualified, your 10th standard in the top 1% bracket. That's why you are here. So, but the intention is to do research, whether it's engineering, medicine, agriculture, pharmacy, whatever it is, whatever the science branch you are going to do. But I urge you to do research in that particular area. In engineering also, there is plenty of research area which are there. For example, nanotechnology, which is a wonderful area, where lot of applications are there. And probably in another 50 years, new area will open up for computer science engineers or electronic engineers, that is quantum computing. Still it is in its starting or early stages, quantum computing is only in the theoretical stage, but probably in after 20 years or so, you may get the, you know, practical experience of quantum computing also. These are all in the engineering area. There are plenty. That is what you are expected to do after attending this Inspire camp. I thought that after attending 5-day or 4-day camp, many of you would write, say that I would like to pursue, you know, basic science. Yeah, but less number. Yes. Yeah, BSc agree, another professional course. This is very, very important for a country like India because we are an agrarian country. Even now, even though of course the trend is changing, 60% of our profession is agriculture or agriculture allied jobs. So still it's a growing field and there is a lot of opportunities in the agriculture field. But again, research is important, particularly in the area of, you know, water usage. Agriculture area sector consumes 60% of our water. And there are examples like, you know, in Israel, the water requirement per quintal of, say, rice or paddy, wheat is very, very less when compared to the amount of water what we use in India. Why it is so? There's a big question. Even though many people go there, study the agricultural practices there, still we are unable to implement that. And over and above that, we need to do research in the water requirement, maybe genetics, plant biology, now GM crops, genetically modified crops, lot of opportunities available. Again, don't just stop your study to do BSc Agri or MSc Agri. Proceed further. Do research, pioneering research in this area, because this is the area which is very, very important for a country like India, because their population is large and no other field can provide job to so many people. Why India is still, you know, it is not influenced by the global, you know, financial crisis and so, because majority of professions are based on agricultural, you know, field. That is why we are not hard hit by the global recession or any such financial problems. So we need to strengthen up this area by doing research in this area. And I wish you all the best, those who are opting for this area. Okay. IAS and one more group. NDA and also combined. There is one more, which is combined. Yeah, civil services and astronomy, which is the group? This one. Yeah, here is an interesting input. You have opted for civil services. Civil services is purely administrative job. Of course, you require, you know, general knowledge in all the fields, whether it is science, arts, or commerce, or whatever it is. So if you are interested in civil service, my advice is don't pursue any professional course. Majority of the, you know, many candidates who pass out the civil service exam, they would have done engineering or medical or so, but that trend is not good, because you don't require hardcore engineering knowledge or medical, you know, science or even agriculture science to do an administrative job. It's highly paid with lot of power in your hand. That's why you think that it is easy to get into that if you are, you know, if you do engineering. It's not true. If you want to do civil services, better you opt for any, you know, field like BA or any such fields, and devote more time to write the competitive exams and prepare for the competitive exam. That's the best way, and also that will help the country. But doing engineering and coming out with flying colors, then joining Indian Administrative Services is not all that good for the country. Personally, you may like it because it's easy to get into that. But I suggest, because you are in the top 1% bracket, all of you should do research in whatever the area you pursue. But in administration, there is no much scientific, of course there is mathematical modeling and all, they are required, but IAS officer will not do research in that area because he is mainly, or he or she will be handling people, okay? So, and interesting part is few people have written civil services and astronomy. These two are two diversified areas. If you have both, interest in both, better you select one and decide now itself. Astronomy is totally a different subject where you are not bothered about what is happening around you. You are bothering about what is happening beyond our planet. Maybe stars, galaxies, neutrons, neutron stars, pulsar stars, and so many things. Or black hole, black matter, dark energy. Wonderful area. But don't combine these two. Civil services and astronomy, they don't go together. But there are very good internationally recognized institute to pursue astronomy. If you are interested in astronomy, do a good physics in your undergrad. Then go to MSc Physics, or you can directly join many institutes which are there in India. For example, Indian Institute of Astrophysics in Bangalore, and also in Ahmedabad, and so many things. And also in Pune, there are two institutes, IUCA, Inter-University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysics. These are the wonderful internationally recognized organizations dedicating for astronomy and astrophysics. So there you can pursue your MSc and PhD also together as an integrated course. So you can join that. But before that, do a good physics in your undergraduate studies. So if you are inclined to do astronomy, wonderful field. There are a lot of opportunities for research. And don't connect with civil service. Okay, civil engineer or civil services. And last one probably. Now, to summarize this, why I have took up this particular topic of career guidance is, the objective of this Inspire camp is to motivate you to pursue research. Don't be under the impression that you are asked to do pure science. That is not the overall objective of Inspire program. The overall objective of the Inspire program is to make you or to motivate you to do research in whatever the area you select. The reason is, no one, all students or all the students who pass out from a university or a degree college cannot do research. The research they can do, but the quality of the research what they can do would be inferior. We need top quality researchers in India. There are plenty of research organizations which have been started in the recent 10 to 15 years, okay, in the 10-15 years, there are so many internationally recognized organizations to pursue research, but the talent is not there, the students are not there. So you can construct building, you can import equipment, you can set the project, propose the project and all, but a professor cannot do the project, right? He needs students. So, and what type of students? Not ordinary. Ordinary in the sense, those who can do other work better, they need not do research. So only talented youth can do research. How to identify the talent? So one criteria which is applicable is those who have done very well in their 10th standard and those who do very well in their class 2 or 3rd standard. They are generally, of course there are exceptional cases in all the arguments, but if I take say 1000 students who have scored 90 above, at least 500 to 600 would be, they are good in doing research or analyzing the problem, critical analysis, rational thinking, all those things would be there in the top, students who have passed out with 90 plus. So this is the logic behind this. So the Inspire scheme selects the top 1% students across the country, conduct this type of camps. There are more than 250 camps held every year for 11th standard students, but only top 1% in the respective board examination, and invite scientists from various fields and tell what they are doing, why it is inspiring, why it is interesting. So then you get motivated. That is the objective of that. Of course, there are so many rewards and scholarships and so many things attached to that Inspire scheme. Anyone can Google that, go to Inspire website or DST, then Inspire website, you'll get all the details. So the whole idea of this scheme is to identify the people, students, who are good and ask them to do research without bothering about how to sustain myself or how I get my bread and butter and all those things, because there are scholarships attached to all type of, you know, schemes under Inspire. So we need this type of scientists who can do research, whether it's medicine or agriculture or any other field. Above that, whether you are a scientist or a lawyer or an artist or anything, there are some basic requirements. That is, we have to be in this planet, and this planet should be hospitable. Right? We need good air, good food. Right? These are the basic, and also sufficient energy for our existence. So we are advancing in the last 10,000 years in so many directions. Our knowledge is exploding. There is multi-dimensional explosion in various fields. But what we have forgotten is, due to the scientific advancement, what is happening under our foot? We are just, you know, the country is collapsing, not country, the planet is collapsing because of the wastage we are creating, because of the pollution we are, you know, injecting into the atmosphere, because of the reduction in water availability, and so many things, and reduction in green energy. So the gist of my talk is, what are the green technologies that can be adopted? What type of research you can do in your respective field? Say if he is a physicist, he can think of doing or developing some technology or some, you know, basic principles of a technology which is, you know, green in nature. Or a doctor or a medicine researcher in medicine, medical field, can think of some treatment or some, you know, treatment methodology which is green in nature. Or a chemist can come out with some green technology to clean the atmosphere or clean the ocean. So the overall idea of this presentation is how you can pursue your research in various fields, but the focal theme is that it should be green. You need not do research, nothing will happen to planet. Only thing is, our, you know, advancement may get decelerated a bit, or it may slow down a bit. But if you do something wrong, that will accelerate our extinction. So what is important, whether to exist here or to pursue research in whatever the way we want and get wiped out? Because, you know, Stephen Hawking, who died recently, the famous physicist, he made a statement that in another 600 years, we have to find out a new planet to migrate. That is the statement given by the topmost scientist in this world that time. No? See, you know about Stephen Hawking, I need not tell you about it. He made the statement, in another 600 years, if we don't change our path of development or our progress, we have to find out a new planet. Because we are advancing in all the fields, but we have forgotten what is the basic requirement. So this presentation is something, it will throw some light here and there, what you can do. Even if you are not a researcher, even if you don't do any job, you may do become an entrepreneur. Still, you can practice certain green technologies at your home, in your day-to-day activities, what you can do. So these are the few issues. And if you are a researcher, you can do a lot of research in this area. So what is green? It is a technology which is environmental friendly and conserves natural resources. So there was a famous philosopher, come businessman, come industrialist, come researcher, Schumacher, EF, not Michael Schumacher, the Ferrari driver. So he wrote a small book called Small is Beautiful. It's a small book of, you know, maybe 110 or 120 pages. It's maybe available in Google, you know, net also. You can download that and read. The title of the book is Small is Beautiful. Whatever you do, if the scale is very small, it doesn't harm the environment much. And he says in one of his quotes is, the resources are finite in this planet, and you cannot have infinite development with finite resources. See how profound the statement is. With the finite resources available on this planet, you cannot have infinite growth or infinite development. See, we know what is our buzzword, development. We need to develop. We have to create more. From where? Law of conservation of mass says that you cannot create mass. So, but you want to create. I want more buildings, more highways, more, constructions. But these are all required raw material, which have to be available in this planet only. But the raw material availability is finite. When the planet was formed, maybe 450 crore year back, 450 or 460 year crore back, what is the amount of nickel we had, or what is the amount of iron, what is the amount of cadmium? That is not changing, right? Once it was solidified, there is no change in the quantity of these resources available. What is the quantity of water available? So the resources are finite. So if you can use judiciously, then it is green technology. And also, if you do research in that area, basic research, then it becomes green science. So it's also known as environment technology and green technology. Now, why do we require green technology? Already I told you about this. Basically because of two reasons. One is threats to mankind. Because we are not in the path of green, we are invoking or inviting so many threats. Just for example, last month we had calamities in Kerala and also part of Karnataka, that is Kodagu. What is the reason? It's not natural disaster, it's a man-made disaster. It is nothing to do with rain, the intensity of rain. That much intensity of rain has happened earlier also. So then why? It is because we have not maintained the catchment area or the area where it rains properly, okay, or in a healthy condition. So the threats to mankind, we are invoking so many threats. Above all, I'll give you the list of threats the planet is showing. This is one thing, one small problem, that is landslide in Kerala and Kodagu, drought, flood, and so many things. But there are many threats, and that's why we have to pursue green science and green technology to understand these threats and how they are man-made, what are the solutions. We should be cautious in our future research. We should be cautious in our future development. Any step we take, that will determine how long we can exist here on this planet. So the entire focus, whether it's in biology or chemistry or botany or whatever, microbiology or whatever it is, except maybe astrophysics. Astrophysics may not affect us in the near future or beyond our stars, whatever the study we take, that may not affect our future. But all other research finally decide what is the future for us. Okay, that's why we need to address, that we have to pursue green technology. Second thing is unsustainability. All the technologies what we are using now, most of them are unsustainable. For example, power or electricity. It is highly unsustainable because we use coal, particularly in India. 60% of our electricity comes from coal, burning coal. How long you can burn coal? Two issues again. One is availability. I said no resources available in an infinite quantity forever, because the sources are finite. Second thing is, by burning so much of coal, what are the problems we are facing? So that is not sustainable. Our water, we use so much of water, we import water in dams, and we do agriculture or any industries. No product which is made is without using water. Even if you take cloth, for example, one t-shirt made out of pure cotton only will require at least 1500 liters of water at various stages in the process of production. From growing the cotton, transporting it, doing processing, yarning, and all those things. Finally, you dye and then dye, D-Y-E dye. Huh? Then finally, you get the cloth on your body. That would have taken 1200 liters of water, even for cotton. But if you take a synthetic or any type of cloth, that would have consumed much more water. Or food. If I use the food which is in my grown in my backyard, that would have taken less water. But if you bring food from US, like oats, the fashion for nowadays is to eat oats. Right? Oat is not an Indian crop, so we have to import it. Large amount of water is spent. Similarly, this one, what you call, jowar, of course, less because it's a dryland crop, or wheat requires a lot of water. Or if you take, you know, non-vegetarian foods, they require much more water than agricultural or the vegetarian food. Like that, what is this? These are all unsustainable because the water availability is fixed. If we consume more, the future generation will be, you know, they will be in trouble. Already we are facing the water crisis. People say the third war would be fought on over water, not on any other issue. Because water is the precious commodity. Without water, we cannot live, right? So, but everything and any activity, even if you own a car, it means to produce the car, lakhs of liters of water would have been used at various stages. So we have to think about this. What is green and what is not so green? Okay, so just few facts about Earth. I just skip that because most of you might be knowing this. It is the only planet which is having life supporting system in this entire universe, and it has atmosphere, wonderful atmosphere, which prevents us from UV radiation, and also ozone layer protects from UV radiation, and it prevents us from meteor showers, and also required temperature, not too hot, not too cold. Only our Earth has this protective layer, so which prevents us from, you know, dying, or we would not have evolved if there is no atmosphere. So no need of saying that without our atmosphere we would have died. We would not have evolved at all. No life form would not have evolved if there is no atmosphere. So this, because of this atmosphere, we are here. And now we are poisoning this atmosphere. That is what we have to understand. And it rains. And these are the problems because we have not pursued the green technology. What are the problems we have? Like environmental pollution. Of course, we know that recently in last post-monsoon season last year, Delhi had lot of problems in terms of, you know, the smog, which results in smoke and moisture. The reason is that people say the paddy or the wheat husk that is burned in the fields of Haryana, farmer's land, that has created this. Apart from that, Delhi is highly polluted because of its vehicular traffic. And why there is so much of vehicle? Because of development. So you want development at the cost of what? And wars, biological, chemical weapons of mass destruction. Earlier, maybe if you go back in the history, 500 years back, if there was a war, it would have, you know, restricted to few hundred or few thousand people because they would not have, you know, traveled a large distance because there was no vehicle. Or even if they would have fought with, you know, iron rods, right, or sticks, it would not be so much destructive in nature. Because of our scientific advancement, if there is a war now, what happens? There are nuclear weapons, right? The quantity of nuclear weapons what we have can wipe out the entire planet maybe 20 times. That much nuclear weapons or nukes we have in various countries. Okay? So how it happened? Because of our scientific advancement. Einstein said E is equal to mc square. Oh, so much of energy in a small quantity of mass. Wonderful. But what did we use it for? We have created nuclear bomb. Of course, we tested it also. Fortunately, after 1946, no other test has been done on any, you know, civilization in any, on any city. But it is happening at various places, and the intensity or the destructive power is also increasing. So anytime it can happen, a dictator may come and he will trigger the button, the whole planet may get doomed. Whom to blame? To blame our scientists only, right? Because they are the people who gave this weapon. Because we didn't think about it while developing or doing the research. So what we should think is, whatever the research we are doing, is it beneficial to the mankind or not? That is the first question. then you pursue the research. Okay, so that's how what you have to do. And also the last one, global warming. This is the mother of all problems. So it is because of all the activities that are taking place, we emit carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide holds the energy of the sun radiation and it heats up the globe. And because of this global warming, all these problems, even the H1N1 or the bacterial mutation, Professor Shishidara was mentioning, why bacterial, bacteria, they mutate, or they are more stronger than human beings, because we have the life cycle of 30 to 40 years. Then once in 30 years, one can get a new generation, right? But bacteria can do that in 5 months or 2 months. So there is more chances of mutation and more chances of new type of species. That is why bacteria can wipe out human beings. They can quickly overcome the, medicine, whatever we give, and they can get an accustomed, or they get resistance to these type of medicine, and they can infect us in no time. So then why it is because, and this mutation rate also increases, it is found that because of global warming. Now, there are many type of bacteria which have come up now because of high temperature, which is conducive for this, mutation. So we need to address this issue before going for any further discovery or any research in the area of comfort. Most of our research is focused on how to give more comfort to human beings. Beyond that, of course, there is some research purely based on interest or curiosity. How the black hole sucks the mass. A lot of research is going on, right? That is purely out of curiosity. But most of the research which is happening in the planet is to see how we can give more comfort to human beings. But what is it required? More comfort means, I say, more diabetes. The very reason why India is more, they have more percentage of diabetes in our country is because our food intake is not changing, because it takes time to adapt to new type of food intake, or our food intake is not decreasing, but our physical work is decreasing. Why? Because of the comfort we got from the technological advancement, right? Earlier, I used to go to a shop and get the thing, but now I can order it my mobile, and the person will come and deliver the goods. So I can sit in front of my computer or TV and get the things and eat. This is comfort, but what is the result of this? So not only killing myself, it is killing the entire humanity. So now I skip this. This is something to do with global warming. Do you know the physics behind global warming? How many of you know it? Can you please raise your hand? If you don't know, I'll tell, because this is a very important physics. How many of you know about what is this global warming? Nobody? Okay, I'll tell you this. Global warming is precisely like this. Solar radiation comes to Earth, and the spectrum of the radiation depends upon the source temperature. The outer surface of the sun temperature is something like 5700 Kelvin. Accordingly, the spectrum is the energy content versus wavelength. If you plot that, you get the spectrum. What are the different types of radiation you have? What is the wavelength and what is the energy content in the each wavelength bandwidth of the radiation? So that spectrum is decided by the source which is emitting radiation. Even this table or this chair is also emitting radiation. The human body is emitting radiation, but the spectrums are different because the temperatures are different. Likewise, the solar radiation coming from the sun has certain wavelength at certain energy level. Now, once it enters the Earth atmosphere, for this particular wavelength of the radiation, almost all the gases present in the atmosphere, they are transparent. They don't absorb this radiation. So the radiation simply penetrates the atmosphere and falls onto Earth's surface, and Earth gets heated up. Because that Earth, solid matter, or even water, ocean, it absorbs that radiation. So once it absorbs the radiation, it gets heated up. So we know that any object will emit radiation if it is maintained at a temperature higher than absolute zero. So Earth, the typical temperature may be, say, 300 Kelvin or 27 degrees centigrade. So it will emit radiation back to outer space, But the characteristic of this radiation is different from the characteristic of the radiation which is entering the atmosphere, because the source temperature is now 300 Kelvin instead of 5600 Kelvin. Now for this type of radiation, certain atmospheric gases, they have affinity or they have the capacity to offer resistance to go out. So they capture this radiation, in other words. That results in warming up of the Earth's atmosphere. What are these gases? These gases are called greenhouse gases, and mainly carbon dioxide, because of its magnitude, then methane, then CFCs, chlorofluorocarbons. Even the ozone in the troposphere is also a greenhouse gas. Understood this phenomena? So what is entering is red and getting absorbed and going back. Right? Of course, there will be some reflection in the outer surface. The magnitude is less, or the fraction is, it's a less fraction. Now, because of this, the radiation gets trapped in the Earth atmosphere, which warms up. Now, if I take the records of temperature of prehistorical or pre-civilization or pre-industrial record and the current situation, the temperature increase, average global temperature increase is around 2.5 degree or 2.7 degree. You may think that 2.7 degree is very, very minimal. Why should I worry about it? But the average global temperature increase even by 1 degree leads to catastrophic effect in terms of weather patterns, in terms of rising the water level, in terms of melting of glaciers, so many things. And also these new type of diseases. 1 degree average temperature increase results in so many type of new diseases. That is why we are now worrying. What will happen in another 20 years? What will happen in another 30 years? So we need to stop this. How to stop this? Because the culprit is carbon dioxide. Actually, carbon dioxide is not the culprit. The people who emit anthropogenic activity, that's what we call. Human beings emit carbon dioxide directly and indirectly. Directly means by, you know, respiration. We inhale oxygen and send out carbon dioxide. But that is very, very small. But other activities like, you know, using energy, driving our vehicle, or producing so many goods out of raw materials, all these results in building up of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Now, the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is somewhere around 418 parts per million, ppm. If I take 10, what do you call, per million means 10 lakh. 10 lakh air molecules if I take and count the number of carbon dioxide molecules, somewhere around 418 or 19. But pre-industrial results say that it is somewhere around, it was somewhere around 250. 250 is desirable. If it is zero, still nothing can happen, because the temperature would be so cold, the atmospheric temperature would be so low that we could not have survived. So we need warm. But it is not, should not burn us. It should not, you know, kill us. So 420, actually 400 itself is the barrier. Beyond that is, you know, catastrophic. Already we have crossed that. Even to retard that, it will take decades. Even if we stop the amount of carbon dioxide, excess amount of carbon dioxide that we are liberating into atmosphere, it will take another 50 or 60 years to balance this, right? The excess. Then what is the sink? Earlier, what was the sink for carbon dioxide? The major sink is the vegetation. Only plants can absorb carbon dioxide. There is nothing else. Ocean can absorb carbon dioxide, but it will become carbonic acid. We don't want that. Our algae and all marine life form will be affected if ocean absorbs carbon dioxide. So only sink is vegetation. And we are, on one side, we are wiping out our forest. On the another side, we are increasing the CO2 emission. The result is catastrophic. Okay. So, and there's a small video clip. Can you click that icon? Click that hyperlink. No, go to PPT portal. Yeah, click that hyperlink. Okay, let me do that. Right. This is just a cartoon to show the meaning of global warming in an interesting way. It's there, it will come automatically. Wait, wait.
Environmentalists are people who worry about the future generations. Then how can we cut cut down our energy. It's not that you have to cut down per se all the energy, but you shift your energy source from non-green to green. There are sources. For example, solar, it's a green source. Or biofuel, it's a green source. And if you depend on coal or petroleum, it's a non-green source. So, one thing is you have to cut down your energy consumption. Because our population is building up, it's increasing. Our per capita energy consumption is also increasing. Net results is overall increase in the energy consumption. So, one is we have to cut down our energy consumption. Second thing is that energy should come from green sources. Then only we have hope and we can do all research, whatever we want, in various fields we want. If we don't do that, then we can't even do biological research or chemical research or whatever the you want, whatever the area you want to pursue. There is no. And because I need food, clean air, good water. Then only I can do research. Your mom says no food, you go and do study. Can you do that? No. Right? So the basic requirement should be fulfilled. If it is possible, only our technologies are green. Okay? So, the goals of green technology are basically four or sometimes five we say, reduce and reuse. Again, this comes from the philosophy that or the quotation by Suman for saying that the resources are finite, so you cannot have infinite development. So you have to reduce. Whatever you consume, it should be reduced. And refuse, say no to goods. If I can sustain with only, you know, for example, cloth, per year if I require only one pair, if someone gives you two or gives you, say no. Can you do that? You can. Someone gives you a pair of shirts, you should say no unless it is required for you. Well, how do you say whether it is required? You have to check. Reduce and refuse. Refuse is very, very important. So, say no to unwanted goods. It can be your shirt or anything or any product or any food. You are already full, someone offers you ice cream. You say yes. That's not good. Because that ice cream, whatever is made, it would have consumed lot of water, lot of sugar. Sugar again, it is a highly water intensive crop. Remember, in Maharashtra, UP, they grow lot of sugar. But how much water they consume? Very, very high. Instead of that, if you had grown rice or paddy, they would have fed all the entire country using the same amount of water. But they grow sugar, and sugar is not a basic food for human beings. Not required, but still, sugar lobby is very strong. So, if you construct a dam, majority, most of the water will go to sugar cane. That's not good. So, say no, even if it is ice cream. Can you? That is good for society. Reuse. Many of the goods, you use it for some time, then you throw it away. But the idea is, you can reuse it with little modification, little change or repair. October 2nd is Gandhiji's birthday, right? He used to write letters to each and everyone who had written letters to him. He had made them once. Daily he used to spend at least 2 hours to answer me. Letters. And how he used to write letter only on the pieces of paper where one side is full and on the other page of the union and the bottom opens, free space is there, you would use to write that, you know, answers to those questions. So that is reuse. Use the same paper wherever possible. Or it can be for some other application. So reuse, another philosophy of green technology. Then recycle. Okay, you can't use it for any purpose, but you can recycle plastic. You have a carry bag. After its job is done, you just throw it into gutter. Right? That is not good. Can you use it for something else? Or you modify it into some, carpet. Or can you get out of petrol? I will show you some pictures where we have done some work on it. Okay. You can convert it into petrol fuel. So you can replace the fossil petrol. Like that, you can recycle it and renew means totally a different new product can be produced. So these are the goals of new technology. I don't go on explaining all types only if you, we are working. Okay, in that area I mentioned. So this is the target what we are filing up. If I give you statistics regarding the amount of waste we are creating, it is astonishing. Okay, per capita waste production in the global average is 1.2 kg per person per day. Per day, it is a global average. Means how many billion tons of garbage we are producing? Our population is around 6.5 billion global population. Around 7.4 billion per day. The garbage produced is 7.4 billion into 1.2, say 8 billion kgs or 8 billion tons. 8 billion tons of garbage we produce daily. Per year it becomes another multiplied by 350 roughly. So that is 8 of it, around 300 million tons. Sorry, 3000 million tons per year. That is the amount of garbage we are producing without knowing how to handle this garbage. India, of course, you can see it on the roadside everywhere. But in Europe also, they produce more garbage than what we produce. Indian average is 0.14 kg per day per person. Global average is 1.2 kg per day per person. And out of this global average, majority from US, Europe and the affluent or developed countries. What do they do? Each house may have 3 or 4 cars and they replace the cars once in 3 or 4 years. When the new version comes, they simply throw it away and buy the new one. What happens to this old car? They simply park it along the road and someone will take it, the government authorities will take it and put it into a junkyard where they compress and with lot of energy. Right? That is only about car and the plastic what they produce. Manila, the international, the Philippines. Recently what happened is there was a heap of garbage and many people died while trying to climb up and fetch something from the garbage out. So that is the problem. Even in Gurgaon in Delhi, last month, 4 people got killed because of garbage. Can you believe this? That is the amount of garbage we produce. So if we reduce the consumption, garbage quantity will be reduced. But you can also recycle the garbage. Garbage can be treated as a resource, but with appropriate green technologies. See, this is the state of Yamuna River, the holy Yamuna River behind Agra, famous Taj Mahal. This is a picture taken behind the Taj Mahal. How the Yamuna is there. It's a mighty Himalayan river, and in summer this looks like this because of the garbage. So water footprint, we consume a lot. 1 kg of wheat produce requires 1 cubic meter or 1000 liters of water. 1 kg of rice to produce 3000 liters of water. 1 kg of milk, 1 kg of cheese, 1 kg of pork, 1 kg of beef. 15,000 liters of water to produce this. Identify the food which is less intensive in terms of energy and water. It is left to you. You can develop. If it is not available, you find out. You do some research. Come out with a food which has all the nutrients, which gives energy, carbohydrate, protein, or vitamins. But it should require less energy and less water for its production. So that is the challenge for agricultural scientists. That is the challenge for nutrition experts. Okay, so you are into that. Nutrition is another area which no one has mentioned here. It's a wonderful area because the basic necessity is food. No one wants to be a nutrition expert. There is a center for Institute of Nutrition in Hyderabad, NINI, National Institute of Nutrition. It's a very well-known research organization. Mainly to develop food or do research on in food area. Also CFTRI Mysore, Central Food Technology Research Institute, another food research organization. So you can work in that also. So what should be your focus? Produce a food which is green. Green in the sense, less water, less energy. That should be the idea. And of course, there's a solution, nice solution for pollution. Someone researcher has come out with a solution to about carbon dioxide, how you can take out the carbon dioxide from a thermal power plant. See, there in China, they are the most polluted country in the world. China stands number one because of its high use of coal.
We decided to build the largest smog vacuum cleaner in the world. So it sucks up 30,000 cubic meter per hour, cleans it on the nano level using very little electricity, and then releasing the clean air. So we have parks, playgrounds, which are 55 to 75% more clean than the rest of the city. Every month or so, it opens like a spaceship. This is the stuff we are capturing. This is Beijing smog, pollution. This is the horror. We live 5 to 6 years shorter. Children have lung cancer when they're 6 years old. And we realize that 42% is made out of carbon. And carbon, of course, under high pressure, you get diamonds, yes. So inspired by that, we compress it for 30 minutes and making smog-free rings. So by sharing a ring, you donate 1,000 cubic meter of clean air to the city where the tower is in.
So what they have done is, of course, diamond is also another isotope of carbon, right? The structure is different. So carbon dioxide, take out carbon from that and use that as a ring and donate or give it as a gift to whoever like. So in this process, you are donating clean air to the society. So that is the technology available, but not yet in India. Okay. So another problem now we are facing is the last one, that is e-waste. E-waste is the new buzzword, because we use so many electronic gadgets. Again, the technological advancement has created more problems. Earlier, e-waste was unheard of. Now, you go to any house, there will be at least 5 kg of e-waste. It may be in the form of, you know, phones, or old mobile phones, or discarded battery cells, so many things. So, in the coming years, other than the biological waste, the more biological waste, there are easy solutions, at domestic level solutions, but e-waste you cannot handle locally. So you need good technology which requires a lot of research. So one research has been done in Japan, that in 2022 Olympics would be in Tokyo, and they have come up with this green solution for the e-waste. This is the last video clip I show you, and then quickly I'll go to some little bit of work what we have done in our center. What time I should wind up? 3:30? 3:30. If we open up. Thank you. would be Olympics is they use all their e-waste and converting it into gold. If someone goes and gets a medal, it would have been from an old phone from that person's pocket, okay, who knows. So that is the idea. And this is one green solution. But before that, what we should think is, of course, recycling is the next option. The first option is reduce, then comes reuse. So do you require so many mobile cell phones? That is the question. What is the need of cell phone? To what extent we use it? How quickly we replace, we change it to a newer version? So these are the questions to be asked. And finally, how we end up with this e-waste. Of course, Japan has this technology, but still it has to come to all the places. By that time, we would have huge mountains of e-waste in India. So you need to, there is research required in dismantling, handling the e-waste and converting it into other products. And also, our psych should change, our mental thing should change, so that I use whatever thing only if it is essential. That is the bottom line for each and every technology. So renewing means converting a particular goods which is developed for certain use to some other form, so that it can be used in some other application. For example, this is from our laboratory only. This is actually the waste plastic to oil unit, a big unit which converts per batch 10 kg of plastic to petrol-like fuel. It's not exactly petrol, but it is petrol-like fuel. So you can mix this with the conventional petrol and run your vehicle with less emission. We have tested this and it works wonderfully well. Energy balance is also good, means the energy required to convert the plastic and the energy what you get out of the petrol. So this balance is positive and it's a good solution to handle plastic waste. So plastic waste is one major problem, so we can have this solution. This is the device what we have. We have a laboratory stage and this is the pilot plant. Okay. The second one is also similar to this. This is phytoremediation system. Means I came to know that few students are doing project on ETP or STP, whatever you have in the college. STP, sewage treatment plant. ETP, effluent treatment. What is the difference between ETP and STP? In both the cases, whether it is STP or ETP, you are converting polluted water into secondary use water or even potable level. But what is the difference between ETP? ETP is effluent treatment plant. STP is sewage treatment plant. Sewage treatment plant means it caters only to domestic water or used domestic water, sewage. Effluent means it can be industrial water. So the technologies to be adopted are different. What you have in the college might be STP, not ETP. It handles only the what is the output of what is the water you get for this particular ETP? Chemistry lab, then it is ETP, then it is ETP. Okay. So what is this one? This is STP, but it requires only plants, certain kinds of plants, which have a capacity to absorb certain chemicals from water like nitrate, sulfates and all. These plants can absorb these salts from water and also reduce the POD, biological oxygen demand, so that the output water is relatively clean, which can be used for secondary application. So, and further you can treat this in the secondary level with the help of charcoal for antibacterial treatment and also sand for other requirement. And you get good quality water which can be recycled for your domestic application also. So this is recycling of wastewater. What is the difference or what is the green thing in this plant? In a regular STP, you require large amount of power, because the procedure in an STP, you churn the water using pump and you do an aerator to decrease the POD, aerator pump and add chemicals and sedimentation, then pump it to different levels and finally wet it with water. The overall process requires large amount of electricity plus chemicals. Whereas this is known as phytoremediation system. Phyto means using sunlight, the plant grows. So using the plants, you treat the water. This requires no chemicals at all, and power requirement is even 5% of the power which is required for an STP for the same amount of water to be cleaned. So that is the advantage. We have a system here, this is a laboratory system. Now we are installing a 5,000 liters per day system, a big one. So this is one green technology which we are adopting in our campus. The big one will look like this. So it's an aesthetically nice thing to see an STP in this way, right? You use flowering plant, so you won't see it as a treatment plant. It's like a garden. So that is the final view what you get. Another one is, this of course is the old technology and conveniently used in domestic level, that is kitchen-based gas plant. And this plant is 14 years old, working wonderfully well without any maintenance. Simply it converts your kitchen waste into biogas. The advantage is you need not hand that waste or you need not throw it away, and also you get energy. So it's two things in one system. So this is a green way of doing things. So you get typically 25% of your cooking energy comes from the waste you generate. That is the thumb rule. If you generate more waste, you get more gas. To create more waste, you consume more energy. See, waste is something which would have consumed energy at the time of production. So just to get more gas, don't waste more. Right? So, but the thumb rule is 25% of your cooking energy requirement comes from this waste, which is generated as a byproduct of your food processing. So that is, that anyone can adopt. And we have promoted this in a big way at various places. Even if we have it in our institute also, and many homes in and around the world. So there are various branches: green energy, green chemistry, green medicine, green transportation. You name any field, the buzzword is green, whether it is green or not. Because that is where our future lies in. Green transportation, green biology, green building. Green building is very, very important, because in terms of energy consumption, domestic building or housing consumes around 27% of the total energy that is produced in the country. 27% is not a small quantity. It's a very huge quantity. It is more than the transportation sector energy requirement. So you need to be careful about constructing the building and see whether the building is green or not. What do you mean by green building? Green building means, at the time of construction, what is the energy that it has consumed? The materials what you use, they would have consumed energy at the time of production. Cement, iron, brick, so many things. So select the materials which have consumed less energy. Then occupational energy. Once the building is constructed, people live there for at least 50 years in a house. Right? During that period, the building requires a lot of energy. Can you construct a building with certain features such a way that this occupational energy is reduced? That is possible. That type of building is known as green building. So I touch upon only two factors. One is green energy and green building quickly and wind up my talk. So green energies are this one: solar, wind, water power, bioenergy. Water power is not so green because of so many reasons. Because the dams what we construct, they would have submerged vast amounts of water. So you are wiping out forest in one place and you say that your power produced from water is green. That's iron, right? So you cannot claim that. So, but we say it's not so green. But for operational energy requirement, it is of course green, unlike coal. Because water doesn't emit carbon dioxide while producing electricity. So solar, lot of research is going on at the basic level, that is a pure basic research, and also at the application level or technology level. So you can get, if you are an engineer, you can think about technology, and if you are a physicist, you can think about the basic research in solar. Why basic research in solar? Just to give you some number, even the best photovoltaic cell what we have now, they can convert, the conversion efficiency is around 16 to 17% actual and 19 to 20% theoretical.
It means 80% of the solar energy is not converted into electricity at all. So because of the material what we use, can you develop materials, can you synthesize materials which can, which will have higher conversion efficiency? The UK long back only there was some effort. First stage cells, second stage cells, the radiation what is absorbed, the radiation what is not absorbed in the first stage will go to secondary cell, which will have another, you know, bandwidth to absorb the radiation. Like that, then there is a third stage, then overall efficiency will increase. But that didn't come to market anyway. But research is required in order to improve the conversion efficiency of photovoltaic cell. There are other ways of using solar energy, but the best way is to convert it into electricity using photovoltaics. So, but the efficiency is very, very low. This is where the physicist's role is there, material scientist's role is there. And once you have that, then second one is technology, how to make them, you know, make them into panels and how to use the panels into building and how to put them, erect them and connect the, do all the circuitry and all. That is technological requirement, but basic requirement, basic research is required. So solar power is one area which is already in use, but still lot of improvement is expected. There are so many new technologies are coming up. Solar roads already told you, in Tokyo it will come. Already in Netherlands they have started. So much of area is used for roads, right? Cutting down trees. So we say it's environmental disaster. But we need roads for our transport. Then what do you do? So much of road is exposed to sunlight. Why can't you convert that road into solar panels? Already it has been done in other countries. I say this Netherlands. These are the panels and vehicles are going over there. And whenever the light falls into the panel, it gives electricity. Large amounts of electricity. So the recent technologies in solar area are dye-sensitized solar cell, organic solar cell, the cost is less. IISc Bangalore is doing a lot of pioneering work in this area. And heterojunction intrinsic thin film layer, HIT, nano coating of solar cell, nanotechnology is there in all the fields, even in medicine, robotics, or computing. Nano is there. So similarly, solar cell technology also, you have nano coating, make the thin film solar cell with micro coating to prevent it from other problems. But that micro will not give any resistance for the incoming radiation. So that is nano coating of solar cell, which will improve the efficiency. Copper, indium, gallium, solar, selenide, solar cell. So these are the yet to come technologies into the market. So research is required to refine this, to improve this and make it practically feasible. So you are the people who can work in this area if you are interested in physics. Okay. We work in the area of PCM, that is phase change material. Cooking requires large amount of energy in the house. I said 27% of our total energy required is in the domestic sector, construction of building. In a building, if you take occupational energy, cooking energy is the energy which is maximum when compared to, you know, your fans, phones or cell phones or TV and all. If you take the energy component, cooking is the maximum energy requirement. Okay. So then you can use various technologies. We are working in PCM, phase change material cookers, and also we are working in passive cooling of building. So this is another area. You design the building in such a way that your energy requirement is less for cooling or heating. If you are in, you know, Arctic regions, you need heating. If you are in tropical region, you need cooling. So, but you design the building in such a way that your occupational energy requirement is less. So that is possible. So bio is another important green energy, mainly because it gives all forms of energy that we require now. Where you require for transportation, you require for cooking, you require for heating, you require for any other electricity. Whatever may be your energy requirement form, you can get it from bio. That's why, and bio is also a sink. Grow more trees for energy, it will absorb more carbon dioxide, because each plant absorbs carbon dioxide during the production of food. So you have double advantage in growing more plants, more trees, and also develop technologies to use this as energy source. So bio is
mainly suitable for any tropical country because we have the biodiversity, like country like India. So a lot of scope is there. There are many methods by which you can convert biofuel into various end usages. I skip this. So this is, we work on biodiesel production and also bioethanol in our laboratory. And we produce biodiesel and market it. We produce bioethanol and use it in a petrol vehicle. So like that, we work in the area of bio. This is our biodiesel unit. And we do a lot of value addition for bioenergy. Because if I buy seeds and convert it to diesel, economically it's not so viable. Unless you produce byproducts during the process of production of biodiesel. So we work in the area of byproducts. We produce so many things. Yeah, these are the products we market from our center. We have soaps, we have hand washes, we have floor wash, we have soaps of different grades, veterinary grade, washing grade, bathing grade, like that. We produce various types of soaps. Apart from biodiesel, so this is a floor cleaner. Our center is named as Chiranthana Bee Technology Center. So we, for all the products what we produce, we add that Chiranthana. Chiranthana means forever, sustainable, green. All these meanings come from this Chiranthana. Anything which is green can be sustainable. So it is implied, so we have this product. We have composting also, biocomposting. We use all the campus waste and convert this to manure and market it to farmers. That's what we do in our sector. So this is the manure what we produce, Chiranthana biocompost. And we produce purified glycerol, crude glycerol, which is a byproduct of biodiesel, into medical grade glycerin. And we have worked on crude glycerol to ethanol production, purification of crude glycerol to pharmaceutical grade. And also, we have started purchasing the used cooked oil and convert it to diesel. The reason is, used oil should not be used again and again. It will become carcinogenic. But many hoteliers, they do that. So there is a regulation also by the government that one should not use the oil again and again for cooking. So we buy this oil and convert it into biodiesel and market. So that is also we do. And this is the ultimate solution probably, but not yet. Not, it has not come out of the research laboratory yet. So we are the people who can make it possible. So this is called bio-refining. What does it mean? You have a system wherein the input is hydrogen and carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and you add enzymes and such that whatever the output, desirable output, you can get it. It's like in a factory. If you want food, you can get it. If you want energy, you can get it. So anything or any raw material for industry, you can get it. Only difference is what you put here, apart from hydrogen and carbon dioxide, that will give you the respective output. So this is called a bio-refinery, which is a solution for your food, energy, and all types of industrial raw materials. So, and finally, you can get it from sun, using wind, or using ocean energy. So any form you can take the energy and supply it to this. This is a concept where research is going on. It requires an interdisciplinary approach. It requires a biotechnology expert. It requires a chemical expert. It requires a mechanical engineer. And so many people. So, okay, I skip this because it's getting late. Okay. I don't mention about green building now. These are the few photographs of the green technology adopted in a house. Okay. It's to green technology, not polluting the environment. if you want to live here for another 50, 60 or 70, because you are on end. So you have to be here on the planet for another 60, 70 years. I want to be here for more than 100 years. Okay. But for that, you need to